Hello and welcome to another episode of the Self-Made Podcast. In this episode, I get a chance to speak to one of my favourite strength coaches in the world, and that is Tom Hibbert from Winning Strength. I met Tom a number of years ago on a therapy course, learning how to use fat tools. He manages to break information down in such a phenomenal way, as well as creating a great environment for learning, not only in terms of what he actually teaches, but the people he surrounds himself with. I met one of my best friends, Umar, on one of his courses. He's also got a bit of a cult following for being one of the best training programmers in the business. And that goes alongside his own competitive career, where he's accomplished numerous under 90 and under 105 world championship records for the log, and for many other lifts. In this episode, we talk about his journey, his career, you know, what he's learned about being an educator, how he's built the gym, the characteristics that made him successful both in his sport and in his business. We speak a little bit about his competitive strongman competitions, how he developed his love for strongman competitions, and how he kind of gets himself ready for those lifts before delving into the training in such great detail, why it's important to build a base, why so many people skip over to the sexy stuff, and how do we get people ready to move into those big lifts and progress. We have a little bit of a rant about warm-up modalities and how people think they're overrated, as well as so many other gold nuggets. Really, really worth a listen if you're interested in any way about getting strong, which I assume you are because you're listening to this podcast. So a fantastic listen for anyone. If for anybody that wants to follow Tom, follow him at tom.hibbert1 and also at winningstrengthonline.com to find out about his membership site, his coaching program, his gym, and his phenomenal education on the website with blogs and tons of video content. If you enjoy the episode, as always, please share on social media, tagging Tom Hibbert at tom.hibbert1 and me at Kingsley Dutton. We'd love to hear what you think of the episode. And now I'm going to leave you with myself and Tom Hibbert. So Tom, for anyone that doesn't know who you are or who Winning Strength is, tell us a little about Tom Hibbert.
I love these. So obviously my name's Tom Hibbert. I own, my company is called Winning Strength, but there's multiple Winning Strength products off the back of it. So we've got Winning Strength Blueprint, which is a trainer software. It's an app, mainly aimed at program design element. We've got, coming up, we've got Winning Strength School, which is something I'm going to be really, I'm quite enthusiastic about. I'm quite passionate about the training of youths and improving their performance. But also we've got Winning Strength Southampton, which is the gym. It originally started as Winning Health Solutions in 2009. We opened, so it's going to be 12 years this year. But we've been here for a while. That business has evolved. It changed to Winning Strength during lockdown. The reason being is Winning Strength fits me, and I'll explain that. And then we've got Winning Strength Online, which is essentially it's an online platform for education. Now, the education is actually aimed at, it's probably a hybrid. It's probably athletes, because there's some content in there that they can use and take away, some applicable content, but also coaches. Like, here's how I do things. Here's how I periodize. And different things. But no, I've been open in this gym since 2009. And we started off as semi-private and private personal training. That's changed since lockdown. So I suppose it's, you know, coming up to, was it a year and a half, 2 years? It seems really long now. Where it's, as we were discussing just before the call, it's like online on site. So the clients come in, they have their assessment. I give them the program. I'm on the gym floor to help them if they have questions, to make sure they don't do anything stupid. And I tell them the weights of the bars, but they use the app to, you know, drive their program forward. And then, you know, we make small changes based on their weaknesses. So the program's obviously designed around their weaknesses, but then other weaknesses will turn up, which we try and fix with. I don't like the term prehab. I use GPP and motor control. And I've taken that from Dr. Peter Lundgren, who is a very good friend and a very, very knowledgeable man on it. I'm probably most well known for my work with strongmen. Both personally and the athletes I've trained, I love the sport. I fell into it because I used to be a football player, and then I stopped playing football. And, you know, when you're trying to get big as a personal trainer, or you're trying to get strong, it doesn't really, it's not very conducive. So I kind of stopped that, but I needed a competitive sport because I am a stupidly competitive person. Ask any of my family members. They will laugh at you for that kind of stuff. I'm better in my older age, but so for strongman, I competed at under 90 in full competitions. I won England's Strongest Man 3 times. I came second at Worlds once, and then I just kind of fell out of love with the full competitions, and then I set the world record in the log. So I'm probably well known for lifting a log from the floor and putting it above my head. And I had head because my mate broke it by a kilo. I had the log world record at under 90, 166 kilos. And then I've moved up a weight category because I am quite tall, so it does suit me. Tall for strongman anyway, around 6 foot. For the weight category, I was tall for under 90. And I'm now under 105, and I have the British record at 177. I've had a couple of bad comps for one reason or another. But in training, I'm in and around world record territory, provided it doesn't get broken. And I hope to attempt it on November 20th. But the athletes I've trained, you know, Matthias Belsek and Graham Hicks, I got to World Strongest Man final. They'd never been to the final. That was my task. So they made the final 10, so they were top 10 in the world that year. Hicksy, I've trained to the British log record. He hit 220, and it was outside in the wind and rain. It was one of the most impressive things. He got a bit cold for the world record attempt, so it didn't quite come off. But he was in world record shape that day. I've trained various heavyweights all the way down to under 80s. But you know, strength is my passion, which is again why I changed the name. Winning Health Solutions was a good fit. I wasn't sure of my path back then. And then obviously I got involved with Charles Poliquin, and he was my mentor for many years. And, you know, winning health is very, it's all encompassing. So we use that name, but winning strength's my passion. It's not just strength sports. I love performance. I'm known for strongman, and strength athletes, but I have a whole host of, I've got a boxer who's competing in a couple of weeks, 400 meter hurdler, 400 meter flat. So I've got various athletes as well. Strength and performance is my passion.
So when you're going a little bit into that background, you obviously mentioned strength being a passion and transitioning from football. Like, what is it that appealed to you about strongman events? Because obviously, like, if your goal was also to be in personal strength in order to get big, it could have been powerlifting, it could have been a number of things. It could have been all the athletic sports that you mentioned you train. What is it about almost out of the box strongman competitions that appeal to you so much?
As a kid, I'd always watched World Strongest Man on TV at Christmas. I don't think there's a single kid out there that still doesn't do that, because that's what it's on, it's tradition. I think it's brilliant. And I remember the first one I watched was Gary Taylor. I don't know whether it was 93 or 95, it was one of the two. And Gary Taylor won, and he was Welsh, and that was just, he wasn't massive, as in he wasn't tall. He was a brick shithouse. He's got some of the stuff I've heard him do in training, even in today's standard, is inhuman. You're talking 220 behind the neck press. Not jerk, like shoulders, just inhuman. And I just got into it. So I had that enthusiasm as a kid, and I was like, oh, this is cool to try. But one of my good friends, Aaron McGoyne, was doing it, and he got into it a year early. He's like, look, you'd love it. You'd be great at it. So I was like, right, give myself a year. I'll get used to, you know, training for strength, not knowing a single thing about what I was doing. But, you know, we all start somewhere, right? And it just appealed to me. I've always thought of myself as strong. We always think we're big as a kid. I was never big, but I've always thought myself as strong. Actually, as a kid, I wanted to be a sprinter. My idol as a kid was Linford Christie. My mum would wake me up when he was on TV. This is back when we had 4 channels. She would wake me up so I could come downstairs, watch the 10-second race and go back to bed at 9 o'clock or whatever it is in the evening. I remember that greatly, very fond memories. And my uncle was a sprinter, and he was powerful. And he was strong. I looked up to my uncle. I still do. I think the world of him. And he was a sprinter when he was young. And he ran, he doesn't remember much, but he remembers the age of 14, he ran a 10.6, which is quick for a 14-year-old. But he actually preferred the 200. And I got into sprinting, so I thought I was quick, I was powerful. And it just transferred into strongman quite well. I did have the endurance element. Like I had that systemic base. Do you know what I mean? Because as a kid, I did swimming, cross country. I had that systemic base, but I was always strong. I wanted to test myself. I wanted to see what I could do with regards to lifting things. And I was explosive and just found it fun. And I just got into it. And from then on, I did my first comp, which was a first timers only. So you couldn't compete if you'd done any other comps. And I managed to win the under 90 category. And it just, you know, one thing went on from there. And I just, obviously I enjoyed winning. Who doesn't enjoy winning? But I do enjoy the process. I enjoyed learning. Every time I go into a competition, I'm learning something different. I'm learning something new. Like I analyze it. What did I do wrong? What can I improve? What do I need to do next? And it also fit well, you know, it fits well into the business model. I like the idea of training these athletes. So to train them, I thought, you know, I had to prove myself and understand more. It was just a good fit for me, really.
Mm. So obviously, like winning your first competition, that's a relatively short learning curve. So obviously you said you always felt you were strong, you had a good systemic base. What do you feel was, whether it's the character traits you had or whether it's the things you did in the early parts of your training that allowed you to take to it very quickly and get a level of success?
I mean, genetically, because I've done Mudo, my 23, that stuff. So there's various genetic markers that show me I have a good predisposition to power, to body weight. So that I was always quite aware of. I loved flinging things, throwing things, being quick, being explosive. Like, you know, people comment on the speed of my clean and things like that. It's just, that's a natural thing. I don't necessarily train it. It just comes naturally. I think, all right, if you look at it a different way, I think people get into strength training for usually a psychological reason. Like people want to be big because they want to, you know, look bigger because they were bullied, right? So you don't get bullied. So there's an insecurity element. So if you want to get really deep, I won't go into this too much. If you want to get really deep, I wanted to be big and strong because I wanted to protect my mum because my dad was a dick, probably still is, right? So it's probably I got into it because of an insecurity. I wanted to prove myself. I wanted to be seen. So there was an external, not gratification, what's the word I'm looking for? External reward. I was looking for people to see me as that. So it's probably that. Nowadays, I do it more for me. I do it more because I enjoy it. Well, back then, it probably was all that. It probably was the fact that I wanted to be seen on social media. I have no problem admitting any of this.
Yeah, I think that's fair. You're right. I think everybody has that initial sort of like thing that gets them in there. Like the people that tend to be better at anything, whether it's comedians, strength athletes, you know, like it all comes from something early on in their childhood. Like you find very, very, very few people that are purely genetic gifted with nothing that tend to become amazing, because there's something that gives them that sort of like work ethic and determination that pushes them to that extra level when things get tough.
Yeah. I also, as I go back to my uncle, I looked after him greatly, and he did do bodybuilding. He was so physically fit and strong, and I did think, I want to be like that as well. So there was that element. He didn't do strongman or anything, but it just flowed into it.
Do you feel like this is sort of like, you know, in a way, whether it's for yourself or for your clients, do you feel going into training with an event, with something that you are competing towards? I got on a call with Jordan Shallow recently, and we were chatting business, and he said the best thing he ever did was to get into something, do a sport like powerlifting. And I find that like the difficulty when people are looking at building muscle, often people can get lean relatively easily. You got lose 1% of your body weight per week, 8, 10, 12 weeks. I can think about that. But when you're looking at building muscle, building strength, and we'll get into this more later, it's such a big long-term investment of your time. Do you feel like having something that wasn't purely physical helped both the physical goal as well as obviously keeping you passionate about it long-term and get you into it more?
Yeah, no, I'd agree with all that. I love the idea of learning about it. I love the idea of trying to push myself. A lot of it was just, it helped me in my business. But yeah, no, I'd agree with that point.
So going into the business, like the reason why a lot of people that you know that will know you, listen to this, will know you as a guy who's phenomenally good at programming. Now, I heard about you through a couple of people, through Antu and Shapeshifters in Birmingham, who I did the course, I, you know, went on with you, and Umar, who I used to work with you, who trained with you. And just like, in a way, I got on a call with Stefan Kozolt recently. It's a very similar sort of thing. It's this almost this underground cult following. You're not a huge social media guy. You put out really good content, but like you're very, very well known for this. How do you feel you got to this level where I don't know whether you'll call yourself an expert, but where you feel that you're deemed an expert in terms of programming, what have you, have you got to that level?
That's cool. Right. First thing, write one program every day for 10 years and you'll start figuring some shit out. You know, the what's the learning curve? It's like, I know everything and then I know nothing. And then I know some stuff. I think I'm at that point. I know some stuff. I know some stuff. It's funny you say that. Right now I'm trying to understand. So I tend to go over things and relook at everything I do. And the way for me to now do it is to write all my principles down. So I'm writing all my principles down so I can understand things in depth. So one of the things I would always do is I would take one item, like strength, endurance. Let's look at energy system for strongman. I was like, you know what? I'm not putting enough work in on this. I don't know enough about this. So I went and I did have many hours of study on energy systems and right, I'm not fucking doing this. I could do this, or I could do this better. Or this is another system. I get bored really easily when I just program the same thing over and over. So I'm like, how can I make this better? What principles am I using? What am I not using? What should I be using? The simple answer to your question really is, again, it comes back to Charles. And I don't know if Stefan is the same. I don't know what he said. I know of Stefan. I've never met him. I've read some of his content. I think he's an incredibly intelligent guy with programming as well. So yeah, I would classify him as an expert for sure. But Charles, the way Charles would think about programming, just it fits with me. I don't know whether it was his German / meticulous mind, but German thinking. He's not German. I know that. But you know that way of that efficient, systemized numbers, numerical. It's maths. It's graphs. When you look at it, and I can just look at it and see it. But he's definitely the base of my pyramid, right? So if we talk about your base is only as wide as it is tall, I still think he gets regarded in every circle. If you go, who's the best program design expert out there? They talk about Charles. I think he was onto something with his fire type, earth type, wood type. I think he was onto something there. I don't think it's perfected. I think there's a big element of personalities. I also think in today's day and age, you get a different spread on the Braverman. But Charles was the base, and then everything else is on top of that. So Louis Simmons, the way he does things, is on there. There's snippets of Shaco. Like again, these are all the best powerlifting and strength coaches. But Charles was the base, the pyramid, and then it was just practice. You can read as many of the texts as you want. It's not going to get you anywhere until you start writing. Charles used to recommend this random guy, James Altucher. I think he just writes a blog. So sometimes Charles would recommend something. I'd look at it. And I didn't really pay attention to it. But some of the stuff I picked off Altucher was he does writing, like descriptive or creative writing. And he says writing's a muscle. Well, your program design muscle, that area in the brain that you think, if you're not writing a program every day, I don't care if you have a client or not, make up a case study, understand it, or just do one element. Like I said, I'm writing a program for a strongman. And I looked at it, I'm like, I'm so bored with writing the same style. And I was like, right, let's look at the energy systems. What does he have? What does he lack? Let's do it like this. Let's take a longer run up. Let's use a Russian approach. So there's many different approaches I use. So the approach was like, what's the GPP? What's the SPP? What's the competition phase? How does it progress through like that? And I was like, let's look at it like that and run it like that. And then I was also, I happened that weekend just to stumble across one of Owen Lacey's videos. And again, he's an expert in programming. He's an expert in many things. I know he loves functional nutrition, but he's good at programming. And I was like, that's an idea. That's a concept. And I can use that. So the base of my pyramid is learn from Charles, learn from Louis Simmons. Those are the two most. If you want to go back further, go and learn from Verkashensky and Dietmar Schmidt-Bleicher, because Charles, you may not quote him, but I seen some stuff that's fucking verbatim. I'm talking 1970s text that is verbatim what Charles had in his textbooks. I'm not saying he plagiarized it, but it's uncanny that it's identical. And look at the Russian stuff. I speak to Dr. Peter Lundgren about this all the time. And there's another, he has a weightlifting expert called Inge Johansson. He's a Swedish, he's very well known in Sweden for weightlifting. And he doesn't speak English, unfortunately, otherwise I'd fucking call him every day just to pick his brain. But it always comes back to the Soviet text. Look at them. You may not agree with all of it, but if you're looking at strength and performance, everything comes back to them. There's nothing new. Nothing new. I know even Louis says this. You look at his website. I bought all those books, all the Soviet texts. Read through all of those as the next bit. After reading Charles and Louis, read the Soviet text. But in the middle of all of that, you must keep writing.
I totally agree with this. And I'm it's sort of the way that my program has gone over the last number of years. I got very, very good at one style of program, which we spoke a little bit about off air, but like, and very good at a sort of one system. And then how my program knowledge has got tons better in the last like year to 18 months was like, right, where are the holes in my knowledge? And as you said, it was like, okay, I'm gonna basically create, where's my initial phases? Where's my structural balance phases? Where's my GBP? I generally call it a reset phase. How does that branch up? And then when I find that I get stuck and I go, I don't know where I'm going with this branch. Then I go, okay, where can I learn that? Okay, I don't know enough about conditioning. Can I go and look at Joel Jameson's work? Can I go and look at Luke's work and Luke Lehman's work and people like that, or yourself? So you obviously mentioned there a little bit about, find those gaps in knowledge and saying that you get bored easily. So, I mean, I'm very similar in terms of getting bored easily, but something that I've heard you speak about in person when we've spoken, I've heard you speak about this on podcasts, and you sort of went around this then, is the importance of a system. So if you're someone like you're saying that you're kind of getting bored easily, what allows you to focus on certain things and stops you jumping around in different places? How have you managed to sort of been able to create your own sort of system for working that you sort of build things off?
The underlying factor for that is a hunger for knowledge. I think my grandfather's like this, and he was a genius. He went to Cambridge at 16 years old, like proper genius, like very clever man, could speak Latin to you kind of thing. Obviously once you learn something, it's easy, but hunger for knowledge. I don't like not knowing something. Okay. Especially in an area where I would like to be considered one of the world's best. I'd like to be considered an expert. I think what you said there was it flattered me. I was very grateful. So I have a hunger for knowledge, I have a hunger for learning. But it's just the way my mind works. If I don't have a system, I don't know why I'm doing something. So, I'd use Charles's system and then I just practiced. I would use things and go, what happens? Whereas a lot of people these days, right, here's the feeling I get what happens these days. I could be wrong. The problem I get is I don't do a lot of interviews of trainers. Like I don't go and sit down with general trainers because just I don't do it. Okay, maybe I should. I've lost my train of thought now. But here's what it was. So I don't believe trainers go out and try something. So when I knew fucking nothing, and that's, I know a little bit now, when nothing, sat there listening to Charles, I'd be like, I'm just going to go and do it. I'm going to go try it. I don't care what he said. He could have said the most crazy shit, and he used to, right? Regardless of whether you think he was great or not, he said some crazy shit, and I would just try it. Does it work? And I would then guinea pig every single one of my clients. They're my guinea pigs. That's what it is. There's no significant bodies of research on periodization models. There isn't. There's articles on how to do certain things. But I would just take something and I would try it and figure out where, who, and why. And then because I've been doing that for 10, 12, I suppose it's 14 years now, I've been self-employed personal trainer or strength coach. You just start to see trends. You start to figure things out. And then it's just the way my mind works. I don't know what that is. I know Charles is like that. I think Stefan's like that. I can see in the way he programs, and it's the methodical approach. I think you need a mathematical base. You need to understand graphs and numbers and flows. I don't mean in depth. I don't mean you need significant levels of algebra. I'll give you an example. I bombed on my AS level maths, pure maths and statistics. It was fucking boring. I just thought it was a good idea at first. I don't think you need in-depth levels of maths, but I think it's that. When I present things to people, it's all about pyramids and it's all about graphs.
Yeah, I'm in some ways I'm very similar in terms of the mindset that you are. We share a lot, and in some ways I'm very, very different. And for me, like I've got a little bit of ADHD, so I've got this drive for knowledge in that same way that I when you said that I don't like not knowing something, especially in an area where you want to be world's best, that's really hit home. Because I've had days where you'll get a message where a client says, this hasn't worked, or oh, I'm feeling this, or oh, I've got a nickel, and I'm sitting there, and that I can't focus less tonight. I'm sitting there. I could be out for dinner, and I stupidly check my phone and look at WhatsApp, and then I'm like all day. I'm like, what? I'm not paying attention. I'm thinking, trying to find solutions. But for me, I'm a big guy of pushing systems now, because for so much of my career, certainly the way my mind works, I struggle with systems. I always have, because of my ADHD, and I'll bounce through things. I'll go through periods of hyper focus where I'm on my laptop for 8 hours a day creating 7 million programs, and I sit there in front of a GBC program which I've written for 10 years and not be able to start. And because of that, I realized for so much of my career, I didn't have that. And because I didn't have the system, I gained knowledge for knowledge's sake. And to a point where I got to three or four years in, when I was at UP, and be like, I know a lot of stuff, but I could apply about a third of it. And why is it that trainers were coming in and, without sounding arrogant, knew nowhere near as much as me? I was educating the trainers, but they managed to get results so fast. And the difference is they were just, is it the Dunning-Kruger effect, what they call it, where they just sort of like, you think you know more than you do, and you just follow something incredibly basic. These guys knew nothing, but they just followed that. Whether it was right or whether it was wrong. I thought, what can I learn from this? And it was like, I need to be able to put my knowledge into a system so I can go, this is mine. So I can go, this is great. It fits in here. This is great, but it doesn't work in my model. It doesn't make it bad. It's just a tool that I'll use sparingly. This isn't good. And now I know why, because I sort of have first principles. And I know you spoke a lot about initial principles. You said it earlier on about writing them down. When you're looking at strength training, I know this could be such a big thing, but what are sort of the things you come back to as the underpinning principles about getting somebody stronger?
Right. If you can't answer this, then you're not an expert. You said this could be difficult.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be. So if we just look at maximal strength, we're not looking at athletic performance or anything like that. We just look at maximal strength, which obviously applies to strength sports, powerlifting, weightlifting, strongman. You must build a base to build a peak. Done. Okay, so how do I build a base? I use multi-frequency training, or I use more assistance work, or I use another way of looking at it is your 10 RM feeds your 5, which feeds your 3, which feeds your 2, and then gives you the 1. Okay, so if you know that a base needs to be built before you can, because it's like energy systems, but for strength training. You must build a base before you can build a peak. You can't just go in and start lifting maximal weights. I get there's programs like the Bulgarian method. Let's just forget things like that. Those are stuff I use, but you got to use it with the right person when you look at the research. So, if we go back, 90% of what I do is the same. But then it's bringing in, and this is probably what I think people say I'm decent at. I bring in the things I'm like, you need more of this. Now, the thing that underpins everything that I'm thinking of now is speed. It's velocity. I'm not saying I don't call me a velocity-based trainer, because that would really piss me off, okay? I'm very good at getting people strong. And strength qualities have a relationship with each other. So I can watch somebody's deadlift, and I don't even need to ask them questions. You can watch them deadlift, watch the speed of the bar, look at the weight, understand what their max is, and then go, this is what you need to work on. Often, whatever they don't do, they need more of. They lift it slow, right? You need to work speed. They lift it quick, right? You need to work slow. You get what I mean? So it's knowing where they are. I mean, you can delve into more questions and get more answers, but I know when to pull the tools in. I know when to pull eccentrics in. I know when to pull isometrics in. I know when to give them a shock week or an overtraining week, as it might be known. But the system's easy. Base of pyramid, peak. That really is it. And that can apply with, remember we spoke about just a minute ago with GPP, SPP. So GPP is the bottom. SPP is an expert competition. It's always a pyramid. So it's always that, and moving sequentially. That is the biggest thing I struggle with. And I'm I'm getting uptight about it now, because I'm going on into a rant nearly, because I have this problem. I have this problem recently. And you know what? I need to be better at being able to just not be in fight or flight when I respond to that. Just be happy responding the same thing to everyone. But when you feel like you've said the same thing 20 times to the same person and then all the other 20 people in the same week, you lose your shit. So sometimes it takes longer to build this base of the pyramid before you get into the sexy stuff. This is based on how strong you are and your training age, mainly. There's other factors. You can look at maybe fast twitch fibers. But that's the biggest thing. So I've had recently, I'm telling them, you're going to do this block and this is going to build your base. This is the base of the pyramid only, nothing up here. But here's the thing. Sometimes people do this and all of a sudden they hit 1RMs. I had, and this is an elite athlete. This is a natural athlete, because I know the concept of enhanced versus natural might come up. So he's a strong man. He's UK's seventh strongest man. He came seventh. He beat one guy, but he only did one event or two events. He tore his biceps on the thing. Andrew Flynn, his back squat 1RM was 240 for one. At the end of an 8-week block, multi-frequency, he didn't squat over 220 the whole block. He ended up at a 260 for four. So sometimes you can hit the right program and be like, yeah, we needed to do some squats. We needed to build a base big time for you. And this has helped you massively. But the point I'm making is you've got to do this block and then you can do this peaking block. So we do like this base building, 5RM block, GPP block, Norwegian, whatever you fucking want to do, do that, and you'll hit PBs. People need longer run-ups, yeah? They need to do 8 weeks, slight deload. Right, now we crank it up for a peak another 8 weeks. And the stronger you are, the more that takes. There are definitely freaks out there. You look at Big Z, he didn't really use peaking programs massively. He would just turn up to comp. It would be a max. He'd go back. He used to do comps like every 2 weeks, every week. Very, very gifted man. But when I'm not looking at freaks, and I still think he could have lifted more if he had focused on, you know, this kind of training.
Do you think, see, when you're looking at building that base and building GPP, do you find that it takes longer with more experienced athletes in a way than it does for beginners? Because I can imagine, like, as much as you expect a beginner to have a learning curve, I can imagine there's so many bad habits. I know my training, a lot of stuff I'm now doing is because of all the bad habits of like bodybuilding for, you know, 10 years where, you know, like I can't get overhead. So like you can give up on a log press. Not well. No. So yeah. I love the sort of like disappointed sigh.
I love the log. I love overhead just because it's built into strongman. I'm like, everyone should overhead. Anyway.
Yeah. So like let's delve into that. If you get somebody, let's say like me, or let's say somebody who's very sort of lifted for years and just very pent up, how would that sort of initial GPP phase sort of look? Like, how would you decide the right approach for them?
Sorry, for you? Someone more experienced?
Well, yes, someone of slightly more, maybe, you know, slightly more experienced than me, but like who's sort of like had a lot of bad habits, maybe poor thoracic extension, anterior pivotal. You can see that they've just, everything's just compressed.
Yeah.
Where does that sort of GPP phase look for them?
So, right, another rant.
Go for it.
Most people's training is not fucking training. It's like I said, the GPP and motor control session, they might term it prehab or rehab, okay? Most people's training strength program looks like a fucking prehab program, okay? My opinion, and I know I get why they do it. If you have the time, and I'm talking 20 minutes, maybe 30, it should be done on your rest days. I say inverted commas rest because that's when you can do it. We're talking body weight shit, right? I have an injury recently. And then maybe I'm getting older. I don't know. Like all these factors come into account. But again, if I want to reach higher than I had before, I need a wider base. And I wish Charles was around so I could speak to him about this stuff, or I had access to someone like Louis. I would have had access to Charles. It would have been cool. But I have access to Peter. Peter has access to Inya. So I bounce a lot of ideas off him. So yesterday, picture this. I'm doing iso clams. Is that what you call them? Fucking band around my knees.
Yeah.
I would never do that shit before or during a session. Not interested. The session for me, I'm like, right, what strength quality am I doing? I'm not looking for activation. You should be ready to go during the session. I do use a mobility warm up. I do get the hypervolt on me and I'm ready to fucking go. I'm pretty much ready to squat instantly, even without all that stuff. Okay. And I think that's how you should be. But in my off days, I'm doing now doing GPP and motor control session. It should be separate. So how would I fix that case study? The first step is, you know, see where he is. Can he do general strength work? And can he fit the GPP motor control sessions on other days? And he would do all of that glute bridge, banded stuff. Like for me, I did the clams, and then I was on a unilateral reverse hyper for 10-second holds. And then I got two reverse hypers. Another reverse hyper that I do something called diamond glutes. This is all aimed at the glute med. You have your legs, like your knees bent like that, and then you're lifting your legs up and down. And then I did a shoulder activation circuit, you could call it, just with a barbell, but it's strength related. Okay. None of the GPP stuff and motor control elements, I do not use the same band and the same time of detention. If you want to get better at this stuff, you have to get stronger. That's my biggest frustration. People are like, I'm using the same band. I do 50 band pull aparts. Fucking why? You're not giving yourself anything to adapt to. I think it's fucking pointless. And especially before your sessions. So the answer is I'd have him do those sessions separately, and then I'd train him normally.
Yeah, I literally have just got off a client webinar I do every week with my online clients, talking about like warm up, cool downs, things like this, and the big thing to say with warm ups is don't overcomplicate it. Get your nervous system ready to lift. That should be the aim, is just to walk in, get your nervous system ready to lift. And then if you're a complete beginner, maybe learning how it feels, how the end ranges feel, get some blood flowing to the muscle, learn, actually take things through a movement. But most people will spend so long stretching, sticking a Theragun on themselves, you know, like foam rolling for hours, and like, cool, it might feel better. But there's a reason why you still feel tight a day later. It's because your nervous system goes, I don't feel safe there, so I'm not allowing them to be there. How do you change that? Get strong there so you don't feel so scared there. Yeah. Cool. And then so like, I mean, obviously, another thing we mentioned, you're talking going into that, we've gone into the sort of training realm now anyway, but with the general preparation phase and a lot of things, I bought your spreadsheets years and years and years ago, and was talking about a lot of structural balance stuff and the ratio graphs and things like this. So when it comes to like, if you've got someone who needs a lot of structural balance work, what are the kind of things you tend to see? What are the kind of things that are quite common that you tend to look at and try and solve? And how do you sort of piece together this initial thing for somebody?
So what do I see? I see a lot of different clients, but if we look at strongman specifically, just to narrow the field, strongman, lats and thoracics are always tight. Mm-hmm. Always tight. But just because something's tight doesn't mean stretch it. I'm sure you're aware of that kind of thing. So it's always, so you should always look at both sides of the muscle. So people with tight hip flexors, I'm stretching my hip flexor. What glute work are you doing? So I see a lot of stuff with shoulders at the moment. And with strongmen, I think a lot of it is misinformation. I think a lot of it is, it's not sexy to do shoulder stabilizers. I mean, I posted articles with Graham Hicks to get into a 220 log. We were training shoulder stabilizers at least twice a week. Julius Maddox trains them every day, four times a week. The biggest bench presser of all time, the raw bench presser of all time at the moment. So I do a lot of shoulder stabilizer stuff because they come in chronically weak. I've had a 180 kilo logger. He couldn't do a 3 kilo trap three, which is incredibly weak. It's a good problem though, because they're already fucking strong. And then you make them stronger. And again, they can train harder for longer because they've got that longevity element because their shoulder joint is stabilized. But I see a lot of issues with thoracics. I use, and again, everything I use with regards to fixes, it can't, you know, I'll double check with Peter and be like, what's the latest on this? Peter Lundgren is my go-to guy for that kind of stuff. He is, if I could have him here, it'd be brilliant because I wouldn't have to do any of it. But I would have him do that part and then I would do the rest. A lot of my clients' problems with regards to strongmen, they get fixed with just changing how they warm up slowly, like one thing. I like to think of a critical path. So I do their assessment and I'm like, right, ankles are shot. Just focus on that. I'm a big believer in like the book, was it Gary Keller, The One Thing? Like just nail that. I would rather after 3 months, you'd have great ankle mobility than still shit everything or average everything. Let's just be experts at one thing for a month. So I would focus on the one thing. a lot of the time with my guys with shoulders, it's a case of putting the right exercises in, making sure they're hitting, was it posterior delt, scapular retractors, lower trap, infraspinatus, teraspinatus, whatever it is, whatever turns out as weak. I don't even test them anymore in their shoulder stabilizers in their initial test. We'll test at the end of the block, but they come in just so weak as pointless. And you see it all the time. Then, so the stretching and the dynamic mobility will be added in beforehand. So I will tell them, right, we need to look at some thoracic movements, whether it's prone cobras, whether it's, supinated raises, bent over, whether it's a lat doorway stretch, whether it's the box PNF stretch where you're trying to open up. I'll try and just find one thing. I go, this is your exercise. I want you to get good at this. And then I find that things tend to improve once I get the shoulder stabilizer moving in.
Yeah. So does that help? Yeah, very much so. So you say, and then it's I suppose those things get yourself into a position where you actually then can load them through a large range of motion and then just get them really, really strong in those ranges of motion.
It's exactly that. Once you store these, Charles said it best, like structural balance phase, strength phase, speed phase. Hmm. Okay. Structural balance is written into my strength programs, but I'll adapt things. So if I have a bench presser that has weak anterior delt and I've got loads of time till comp and he's a bit internally rotated, he's going to overhead press for 6 to 8 weeks, no flat press, or maybe he'll flat dumbbell press. But it's finding their major weakness and attacking it. You have to have a critical path. So when you do your assessments, I kind of just see it now. I don't write it down, but maybe I'm a bit lazy. Maybe if I had coaches, I would write it down so they could see it. But after the assessment, I normally go 1, 2, 3. If you don't fix these in this order, and sometimes it's sleep, sometimes it's nothing to do with training, sometimes it's food. I'll go 1, 2, 3, go away. And they're your goals. I don't baby people. I'm not interested in following shit up. You either listen and crack on, or after 3 months, I'll check in and I'll just remind you of it again. Then I'm not a daily, weekly, have you done this yet? No, that's fucking, you listen once. Just my personality.
Yeah. I think I said, like, I actually don't remember who was saying the phrase, but like the best corrective exercise is correct exercise. And like when I look at sort of like looking at a program, it's like, okay, right. If I want somebody to be able to open up the shoulders, be able to get the nervous system relaxed, open up the chest, get the shoulder stabilizers in. So, okay, here's the biggest exercise they can do. Here's the current active range that this person has available to them, right? A lot of people go down the RTS and the biomechanics standpoint, a little bit too far down the wormhole where the active range is half an inch for people listening to this. So it's like, what do they currently own? And in the B series, like, it's the accessory work. What's the stuff that needs to get stronger to allow them to be able to be safe and stable in that range? And then when I'm looking at a C series, it's like, okay, I could choose a rope bicep curl, or I could choose an incline curl and allow shoulder extension with a tricep extension, which gets them to engage lower traps. Like this, all that stuff is like the remedial stuff's hidden into arm training because people like to do it, rather than necessarily saying that people don't necessarily like to do the non-sexy stuff or the stabilizing stuff. And then you can then filter in a bit of that when you get more buy-in and build up from there.
No, I'd agree with the whole hidden thing. Mm. I like that. I'd agree with that. Like, what am I doing for my serratus? Well, we do dumbbell pressing.
Yeah. Exactly.
Neutral grip, protract, retract.
Like a lot of the stuff I learned from Nick Daniel and his course. So I don't know if you met Nick. I'm assuming you might have done. But
sorry, I'm not familiar with Nick. Who's Nick? What's his business?
So Nick Daniel used to work with me at UP and now runs a company called Fitness Rebels. So he's now trained to be an osteo, done a lot of like bodybuilding stuff. So he's now cool. Doing the course that goes into a lot of breathing mechanics and like how to sort of then build this sort of like get people to move better, get them out of the warm ups and get them strong. And like a lot of stuff I learned from him on his current course was sort of like how many ways you can look at changing something like a split squat to allow you to change certain things, loading things in certain ways, contralaterally, like ipsilaterally, like putting it in a goblet position, elevating the front heel just so they don't even have to think about driving that knee forward. It's like you can do so much with that like, do you need to spend 40 minutes in a couch stretch before you start? Or can I start to load in that length and range with an anti-rotation component, with doing something with the breathing? It's like, Okay, I've now done one exercise. That's hard. That actually can help you build tissue whilst you're sort of doing all this sort of structural balance stuff at the same time.
I think I would get on well with Nick in the way he thinks. It's the same as Peter. Like, there has to be a blend. Like, strength training or is it a rehab session? I'm not against these rehab, prehab, motor control sessions at all, but it's not training. And you don't need to do it before you train. But when you do train, the exercises you select or you're prescribing for your client should be thought out with exactly the way you just said. I think that's a very important element.
So when it comes to, like, you've got someone through, you've gone through a little bit of structural balance stuff, they're starting moving a little bit better. Now, as you mentioned, like, picking the one thing, and when you're looking at choosing indicator lifts, like, when you're kind of picking, like, okay, we're going to get strong on this and this, is this something you choose based off preferences, based off what you see, where someone's weaknesses are? How do you start to build someone's program for the long term, especially if you've got a client that maybe come to you that's more body composition standpoint, where getting them lean is easy. We're now trying to say, okay, let's set you up for the next 2-3 years of your training. So, like, how do you sort of get them moving into a more strength-based, like, focused mindset, and how do you pick their big lifts?
I think you touched on it. I think you mentioned it. I base everything around predictor lifts. Okay. I have my own ratios. I have Charles's. I have the Soviet ratios. I've seen Louis actually uses them. This is not a new system. They've all taken it from the Soviet textbooks. I literally have them in front of me here.
Oh, nice.
They're all in there. They're not hard to find. I mean, you know, you purchased from me within that package. There should have been a decent amount.
It's behind so the tab. Open, in fact.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we're trying to incorporate it into the app, but it's not a priority at the moment. We're going a bit to the side, but the app is great for program design, but the structural balance element is going to take, it's just not a priority. We're trying to improve the onboarding experience. Anyway, but everything is based around their predictor lifts. You put their predictor lifts in, it could be three, it could be 12. That sounds a bit much, but the 12 one just lead down, like the, you know, the Charles's one, the most famous, the biochromial one, and then all that kind of stuff. And then it's the biggest error. And then it's looking at their performance and what are they missing. So if I've got a strongman, you know, deadlift has to be in there. They have to keep improving their deadlift. But if their squat isn't increasing at the same time, or at least at a slightly quicker rate, if it's behind, then they're going to get left behind at some point. And they're going to have to do a squat only protocol, which again, isn't the end of the world either. But I base everything off predictor lifts. And then looking at the main predictor lifts and the remedial that goes with it. Again, it's like a pyramid. So you've got the competition lift, then you've got the main lift, and then we've got assistance lift, and then remedial lift. So it's actually something that flows down. So it's like my competition lift is log, but my main lift is front squat, maybe push press from rack. And then it's like, what feeds these ones? And then what feeds these ones? Does that make sense? Dave Tate explains it. There's some good graphs on some of my videos of exactly that. It's like, what, you've got that one, but what feeds that one? And then what feeds those lifts? And then what feeds the one below, each level below? And you come up with a kind of pyramid. And then as you get older, you actually knock away a lot of the stuff. So a lot of the time, you know, my next block, provided my adductor fucking heals, is literally log 3 times a week with front squat. They're the main log 3 times a week. Front squat 3 times. We're going to do doubles for the first 4 weeks. No strict press. And then this glute ham sit up that they used to use in Russia. That's it.
Yeah. I think that's another big thing as well. So I find that I don't want to necessarily call out coaches because I've done it. And I sometimes have to stop myself occasionally doing this as well. But I think people try and do too much. They try and correct everything and end up doing nothing. And I think there's such a talent and an art and an experience level of people that can take all this noise and go, boom, this is what we need to work on. And this is sort of exactly like how we need to do it. When picking accessory lifts is something I thought was quite interesting. Often a lot of the stuff you base around is working around weaknesses and like, okay, what's the weakness in this lift? And I've heard before on a podcast you mentioned there's always an execution issue and there's always a weakness. So when it comes to this, obviously, like, some people you're going to get, everyone's going to have different portions, different limb lengths, and some people's squat using a squat example, is going to be much more hip dominant than the other. Would you still look at the work bringing up the weaknesses if you're looking for the maximal squat? Or would you look at it and say, right, this person's going to be a more hip dominant squatter. I'm going to get their lower back and glutes mega, mega, mega strong because that's going to help them have a better carryover to the squat. Or are you going to go, well, they don't use them there, so let's bring in quads and other things in my accessory work because I can.
Yeah. The simple answer is you're going to hit a wall if you only focus on their strong muscle group. So let's say we're training someone to be a hip dominant squatter. Everyone has a weakness, whether you're, I don't know why Eddie Hall's come in my mind, whether you're Eddie Hall, what other powerlifters have we got that are really good at the moment? Makarov is good, whatever. I don't care who you are, there is a weakness. If you just keep working your strength, that weakness is going to show up at some point. So if we take the example, my opinion on it would be if you just keep working their hips, their glutes, their lower back, they're going to break down at some point. The technique's going to change at some point. So you have to bring up their quads with them. And it's finding the right movement for that.
Okay. So I mean, like, again, this is such a broad question. So obviously when you're choosing accessory work, like for somebody, if we have a coach watching this, who wants to learn a little bit about like, right, I want to be able to choose my accessory work, be able to start learning the foundations of this pyramid. Because when most trainers get in the industry, they're taught, everyone's got a squat, everyone's got a bench, everyone's got a dead because they're the best exercises. When from a pure hypertrophy standpoint, they're probably not the best exercises. They're quite shit. You know, and also because they focus all the attention when you learn it, it's like, oh, I only learn the squat. They probably miss all this stuff, but they go straight to the top of the pyramid. So if someone's coming into this and wants to start now, okay, I want to open my eyes to learn more about these lifts. When you're looking at sort of like their indicator lifts, how do you begin to start to learn, right, that's the weakness there, that's what's going on there, and piece that together? How did you gain that eye?
How they move.
Okay.
You don't need an eye. Sorry. I have this thing where I'm actually quite able to simplify things.
Yes.
And I get told this is a good thing sometimes, but maybe you want a bit more depth. But if somebody's knees extend in a... So their hips shoot back in a squat, it's quads. They're moving away from their weakness and towards their strength. They're trying to load their hips. So it's how they move. Going back to your point earlier, there's always a technical issue. So you identify it and you go, what are you thinking? What's your cue? Why are you doing this? Can you see this is happening? And you figure out the right cue. It doesn't matter what cue, but there is always a technical issue. The reason I said this is because I went round and round them. You know, you have coaches, oh, it's this weak triceps in the lockout, right? So I bring up people's triceps, didn't fucking change anything. So it can't be the answer. There's not many one word answers. Like, it's that. So for me, it's what's the technique fault? What's the weak muscle group? What's the weak strength quality? This comes back to me saying everything I base around and the all of my principles come from strength qualities, which is actually speed of the bar. It's velocity based training. It's how they move. It's watching how they move. Okay, I wrote an article, I don't know when it was, ages ago, but you cannot be a rep counter. In fact, stop counting reps. If your client can't count a rep, then fucking sack them or just say two more. We always say two more, right? How many reps are there? Just do two more. You get an idea, right? You think, well, you've been there for 30 seconds. I want you there for 60. Do some more.
Clients always count reps more than we ever do. Like, it's the clients that always that sort of are thinking about the external rather than the internal. They're the people that's like, we've got 10, this is 12. I'm like, I don't care. I'm looking at your hip, I'm looking at your knee, I'm looking at the speed, I'm looking at what initiates first. I couldn't care less if it's 4 or 40. And like Christian Thibodeau that said, like, good personal trainers should not be able to count reps because they're focusing on everything but.
I agree. I'll back that statement. Back that statement. But so what I'm looking at is what is happening. I know it's a broad question, but what's happening with their technique? So where is it deviating from what you believe is optimal? Obviously, everyone has a different idea of optimal. You can build your own ideas. That's cool. And then, you know, how quick are they moving? It's not a lot to look at. So where are they deviating? Are they kicking back in a squat? Are they, you know, where are they? What's happening with their elbows on a bench press? So what's happening? Like, you know, are they flaring out instead of keeping that lock? So I just write it down, be like, right, what the fuck does this mean? And if you don't know, ask an expert. I have times that I'm like, I send something to Peter. I'm like, what the fuck? This is usually like big injuries. I'm like, what the fuck is happening here? I have a guy that can squat up, down, but perfect. No asymmetrical issues. But we did the Supta Vajrasana stretch. It's a yoga move when you're on your knees and you go back. And he comes back and he goes, whoop. I'm just like, what is happening? Why? I don't know what's happening here. This is beyond my knowledge. So I sent to Peter. You know, refer out is the main thing. So what's happening with their body in regards to what you believe is optimal technique, and what is the speed of the bar or the dumbbells, whatever it is. If you can look at those two things, then you can start to understand a lot more about where their weaknesses lie.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. I remember, I think the things that helped me with this, and I'm so no way at your level of being able to identify this and see this, is like the big things that got me was like, what moves first will work most? So like before I even start, like what's slowing down, it's like, is the prime move that I want that's going to power through this lift move first? No? Okay. There's a massive technical issue here before we even look at anything else like this. And then, and as I said, it's just writing things down like this and asking. I remember going to Christian Thibodeau's seminar, you know, reading a lot of your work while Stefan's work, and was like, okay, I'm starting to see what these guys are doing. And I go, I like breaking down programs. I'll see a program on your website. I'll buy one of Stefan's on his website. And I go, right, why has he chosen that? What's gone on there? And I'll go, and I'll try it. And I'll go, okay, I'm failing there. I kind of see why this works now. Going back into that, because I have an idea, but we could do so many things for examples here. But you brought one up, so I think this is a good one. So you mentioned obviously like using the lockout on top of a bench press, right? The same as weak triceps. That's the general rule of thumb. And I agree with you that rarely ever helps. And if we look at it for the people that listen to this that are into the biomechanics role, this is one that doesn't make any sense, because it's not like failing at the bottom of a squat. You should fail at the bottom of a squat. You should always fail at the bottom of a squat. But technically, the bench press should be easier at the top. It's the lightest part of the lift. So when you're looking at it, and I'm hoping you say the same thing I'm thinking, but where do you go to when it is that some people kind of like get stuck in that top third?
Speed work.
Is in terms of, you think they're not powering out the bottom as quickly as possible?
It'll be a mixture of speed work, triceps work. Right. So again, this comes from Dave Tate. I'll always tell you where I got things from. And it's not that, yeah, Dave Tate mentioned, this is the first person I heard mention it for squats. So it's like, it's not you're weak in your triceps, it's that you're too slow off your chest.
Okay. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
But again, you have to analyze it and just look through it and be like, what's the speed of the bar? Is he going up? Is he grinding? Some people, again, Dave Tate, Louis Simmons, they're like, you can only exert X amount of seconds on a maximal attempt. Yeah. So you've only got 3 seconds to finish that lift. Well, if you're really slow off the chest, i.e. that would indicate weak pec, maybe, really slow off the chest, then, you know, you do get stuck at the tricep point, but it's not weak triceps, it's because you're too slow off the chest. So it's speed work, i.e. can you actually activate those high threshold motor units like that? Or is it weak chest? So it's usually a combination of everything. It's more of everything. But the thing people miss is the strength quality, I feel. That's why I said speed work first.
I would agree with that. I think there's two things. There's that. I think there's if they're slow off the chest, it's weak chest, like haven't got enough power coming off that base. And I often find that people will just it's the opposite side. We talk about both sides of the muscle. They can't stabilize themselves into the bench in the first place. And then you'll find that everything else will go. It's they shrug. The elbows will flare out, and that's always down to either poor extension or terrible scapular retractors. Lats.
Yeah, and I agree, like looking at the opposite side is what you were looking for, and I get that, but I wouldn't know that until I'd looked at all their numbers. I wouldn't be able to spot that watching their bench press. I'd look at all the anterior chain, but if it still wasn't working, I'd be like, well, if I was working with the athlete, I'd know.
Yeah,
because I'd have all his numbers in front of me, like whether I've done data collection or not, he's got them in his program, so I know what he's lifting. I actually, because I reply at least once a day to all of my client sessions, and I'm like, excellent, we found a weakness. Okay. Like I did an assessment the other day on a 400 meter hurdler. I was only a young guy, 18, 19. And I was like, do you want the good news? Your ankles are shit. Like, you have no mobility there. But he's quick, right? But if you're strong or you're quick or you're good with a shit structure, frame, strength, whatever it is. If we make them better, imagine where you're going to be. And it's like what I said with that 180 logger with the 3 kilo track raise. I'm like, this is fucking brilliant, because you bring them up, you're going to be flying.
I suppose there's a balance of it as well, because a lot of it, like, he could be quick because he is, everything's so compressed, there's a lot of power there rather than a lot of elasticity, I suppose, right? Like, I suppose if you went, go too far down the other way, and then you actually didn't, like, sort of lose strength, or do you find that tenter people always get better when you improve end ranges?
Sorry, can you repeat the question? There was a little cut out.
So, like, in terms of, like, do you find this as is sort of a balance between sort of, like, you know, like, expansion, compression, in terms of, like, someone maybe, they might lack ankle mobility, using your example, and that could be the reason why they're losing speed on the table. But do you occasionally find where it's because they're so tight, their nerves are so amped up and everything's so tight that they actually have power, and that actually helps them being quick, as opposed to any of you releasing?
Oh, I get that question. How many weightlifters do you see with this problem?
Yeah.
Is the right? And I know the counter argument already. Like, people be like, well, it's a speed strength sport. Okay, cool. But if you train these guys for strength, they can get strong. Okay. I've seen it. Look at Mikhail Kokhlaev. I know he's an open guy, but he was quick and strong. Like, he was able to do 400 and something odd deadlifts, hook grip. So I'm not a massive I get why people say that, oh, I want tight pecs to slingshot out. I'm okay. Well, you're just predisposing yourself to a lot of other shit, i.e. tendonitis, possible ruptures. And, you know, I don't want my guys hypermobile. I don't believe my powerlifters need Olympic weightlifting levels of mobility, but I'm not for the whole be as tight as possible, because I think there's a margin of error there where it's like, I want you as tight as possible, but what is optimal at that point? Like, with everyone, like, it's difficult. I've seen, like, you know, bench presses. I can't get, you know, 140 to touch my chest. I'm like, I think that's a problem. I don't see that as a benefit with regards to, and this is without a bench shirt. I don't see that as a benefit to performance. I think the margin of error is you're going to break at some point, or your body's going to break down at some point.
I think the key thing there is longevity, right? Like, most people have become world champions and stuff. They very rarely do it on the first time out. So, like, it's all well and good training in such a way, but if they can only get two goals before they completely break, you struggle. And you look at the evolution of sort of like the biomechanics and the RTS, and I love all this stuff. I've nerded out on this stuff for years, but that's come about from bodybuilders who have done things a certain way, got themselves broken, had no longevity, and realized there's a better way of doing this. There's always the anti-mechanics argument of, like, I'll do straight bar bicep curls because my elbows aren't hurt. It's like, well, the people maybe didn't get big biceps doing easy bar and dumbbell curls, but it's because they couldn't supinate. They've started forcing themselves into position. Now they hurt, right? At the start, they say, look after your end range of motion. Get yourself strong through your thoracic and your scapular retractors. Maybe find positions that are slightly better for your structure. But it's come from that being broken in the first place. So it's that thing. It's like when you get someone that's like, right, we need a lot of what, a lot of what you need in terms of getting strong, but a lot of what you need to be strong 10 years down the line at the same time. I suppose that comes back, right back to building that foundation.
For sure. I think an important saying, I don't know who said it, but strength is a marathon. I think if you consider that, then whoever lifts for 20 years is going to be the strongest.
Yeah.
I think another way of researching that subject is find all the retired strength athletes. Like, just message Dave Tate and be like, what do you wish you had done anything different? I guarantee the concept of balance, mobility, longevity, injury prevent, whatever the fuck, you know, that prehab, rehab, GPP, motor control. I guarantee they say, I wish I'd paid more attention to that element.
Yeah,
guarantee it.
And I, as I said, we spoke about this with the disappointed Cy earlier on. I haven't gone anywhere near to the levels of a Dave Tate strength, and I wish at 31 years of old that I'd done that more when I was 20.
Yeah.
You know, let alone where I'll be another 10 years. And now I'm spending a lot more time focused on building that base because I skipped over it. like a lot of people do. And now last few years has been going back and sort of trying to undo all those bad habits.
Yeah, for sure.
So like going into like a little bit, like obviously we talked about like how you get someone strong. Let's go into some of the incredible like success you've had personally as a competitive strongman, in terms of obviously you've gone through, you said you test all these training methodologies out and we sort of know sort of where you're at in terms of who you are, in terms of how you approach this. But we mentioned this off air of going into this of like putting a 177 kilo log over your head is a brave thing to do. Putting a 270 kilo back squat and getting, you know, competition depth is takes a certain bit of mental fortitude. Like, touch a little bit of like what's your thought process going into a comp? Is there anything you do preset? How do you get that mentality to be, you know, really confident under these crazy loads?
I think the first, and I don't mean to be rude, but I politely disagree with you. I don't believe it's courageous to get under these weights, because it's just adding X amount of weight. I know I've done all these weights before. I just have a confidence in X, Y, and Z. Going to your question with regards to what do I do for a competition, I do the exact same thing I do for training. I think if I did anything different, I think that would be a bad thing. I don't save anything. As I lead up to my comp, you'll notice that the sessions will either be more amped up, or like I actually, the last one, I was like, you know, because we've come before, and this has happened more than once, I've been put off by people's cheering. It's a weird thing, right? In the gym, like no one's watching me lift any weights in my gym. Like they're not like, oh, cool. You know, some of my clients have no concept of what I'm lifting, which is cool. I don't mind that. But when you go to a comp, all eyes are on you and people are cheering. I've got the cleanup and I'm almost like, can everyone shut the fuck up now so I can do my press, which is just dumb. So I had people practice that. So I don't do anything different. I try and mimic the competition conditions as much as I can beforehand. But I don't believe what I do I have never needed to overcome a confidence issue with a weight. Obviously you get injuries and twinges, but it doesn't take long to go, okay. And I had one in the last program. There was like a few weeks I couldn't front squat and I couldn't use a safety bar back squat. So I just found a different option. Okay, well, I'll use a barbell. And that was fine. I had an upper back issue.
Do you think the reason why there's never that doubt and there's that level of confidence going into lifts is because of all the experience in the back end work, in terms of, you know, your programming solid, you know that you're getting close to these lifts, you know that you're peaking in the right way. So, and you're very meticulous that I do this, I should hit this. Like, it takes away 90% of doubt, so you don't get into the bar with this is more than I've lifted. You know, it's like X meets, you know.
It's taken experience, but I don't lift anything I know I can't lift. The idea is you don't fail anything in the lead up. Why should you? Why are you trying to lift something? Eddie Cohen said it best. It's like, you only have so many 1RMs in you. Don't do it in the fucking gym. No one gives a fuck. Okay. And there are some gym lifters that can't compete, and it's a different world. This is why I hit the easiest 180 ever, but I went to the comp and I fluffed, because everything, all the conditions were different. And it's another part of the game. It's another part of the puzzle. So the programming side, I was nailed on. I genuinely don't have to do anything different. I could do the same thing. But it's another part of the puzzle. But there was doubt in my early years, for sure, because I didn't know what I was doing as much as now. Now I know, I can program this, and this. And I go, that's going to hit that. But it comes back to the base of the pyramid. Like, did you hit a 2RM before you left? Like in your block, 2 weeks out, 3 weeks out, whatever it is. Yes. Well, you have the strength there for a 1RM. You just have to display it.
Do you think that's a mistake a lot of people make when peaking, is that they peak too early, like in the sense of they're always trying the big lifts, they get too keen.
That's not peaking too early. That is a lack of delay of gratification.
That's a great answer.
I speak about this a lot. Peaking, you have to delay gratification. Andy Bolton, he didn't use those words, but he was the best at it. He would like, just, I don't need to, I don't give a shit what I lift in the gym. I want to know what I lift on a platform. It comes back to an insecurity or an Insta fame or a, and again, I'm not bashing these people. Like, you look at, I can't think of any names, but I'm sure there's some great lifters out there that just lift for Instagram and they're really strong and they don't compete. But it's a different fucking world. Doing shit in your own gym and going and adding in travel, dehydration, travel long distance, short distance, different hotel room. If you're away from your creature, it's a different fucking world. when you should not think of it like that, obviously, but all of these small things can add up. But people don't peak because they can't wait. Mm. It's fun. Yeah. He's like, I want to show it. I'm like, cool. But the thing I can also do, and again, I try and impart this to clients, is I know I am stronger after this training block. I don't need to test it here. I want to test it on the day. Okay. So I did the last training block. I knew I was that day. I did the 180. If you would put 190, maybe more on it, it goes for sure. Not a doubt in my mind. Or if I did it the next week, if I didn't have to compete 2 weeks after that, and I just went to 190 the following week, I'm good for it. But I was like, no, why? I don't care about it to do it in the gym. I haven't done that in a while. It's because my strength had increased so much that 180 was actually possible. 180 is a PB. Normally my PBs are all now at competition. So all the last three lifts I did them all at competition. I hadn't gone heavier in the gym. This one I did because the week before I hit 175 for two, like it was nothing. I'm like, well, we can do a 180 quick single and stop.
Yeah. And I suppose you mentioned it earlier on as well, and so as we said about the travel and the dehydration, but you said about like you'll get more amped up going into that last couple of weeks because it's a different environment. Like being able to be so internally focused going to a lift because you're in an empty gym and no one around, and then to be in a comp environment, the last thing you want, I suppose, is more uncertainty going into a lift I haven't done with an environment that I've not been used to training in. If you know that, I know I've got that, I can sort of zone the rest of this out because I know I've got it regardless.
So it's just about can you now put it together? Yeah, for sure.
So one more thing I just want to speak about before I let you get on your day and look after your members. And this will tie in nicely to a follow-up. So obviously, like we spoke at the start about your career in terms of your career as well as the personal training career and the gym. You know, how did you transition to sort of like being an educator and doing the courses? Because you mentioned at the start you've got this way of breaking things down very simply. And even before you mentioned it, it's in my notes of that the course we did in Birmingham, and like you remembered everybody's name. You remember, I'm assuming it's not just me, like you remember everybody that's probably been on your courses, probably hundreds of people now. You break things down incredibly simply, straight to the point. Like, was that something you feel that you took naturally in terms of like learning how to be able to break these topics down and educate, or was it something that a skill you've worked on like everything else?
No, I've given some seminars where I suck. I'm like, that was shit. And then I learned, I was like, you've got to practice this before you deliver it. I'm not a big, don't tell anyone this. I'm not a big fan of redoing things. So I write a seminar, I'm like, okay, let's crack it. Instead of like practicing it and then redoing it. Now I'm more like, oh, I'll do it a little bit.
Yeah.
I think a lot of it's natural, but I do have a work ethic. I try things on people. I speak to Peter. I bounce ideas off people. Remembering, I think my recall is just good. Mm. I don't want to offend anybody, but you know, I'm sure. So my belief is everyone's on the spectrum. You know, I'd probably be classified as something. Okay. Mm. They would have given me something at school. My sister, because my mum's not with me anymore, but my mum told my sister that I was a fucking pain in the ass until I'd done some exercise. So until I started swimming every day before school, or most days before school. So I was a fucking little terror before I'd done any, and I was just obsessed with sport as a kid. So I'd probably be along that spectrum, right? And it's a superpower, regardless of what people think. It is a superpower to have something that you can like dip in and, you know, be focused and have, you know, recall automatically. So I think I'm probably somewhere along that spectrum. I think everyone is, but recall is just, my recall's good. I'm blessed with that. Maybe it's just a genetic thing, because I know my uncle has stuff like that, incredibly intelligent man. And then as I spoke about with my grandfather being a Cambridge student at the age of 16. But with regards to workshops and seminars, no, I've delivered some shit. I'm sure there's people out there that would tell me I'm cool with it. If you're not getting better, what's the point of being alive? That's probably a mantra. I don't know. I think the Kaizen way of thinking, I'm always trying to improve and progress, and I will ask people. The problem I get is my personality, at least maybe what people see, is different to what they know. Like people don't want to give me feedback. I've had to ask, I'm like, I go to like in the past my coaches or somebody, I'm like, can you go and ask them what they thought? Because they won't tell me.
Yeah.
They'll be like, oh yeah, it was good. I'm like, I don't want to hear that. If it's really shit, I can tell. You just tell by the reactions on people. But I'm always keen to, again, it's that hunger to improve, hunger for knowledge. So that comes naturally. I'm like, how can I make this better? Because it's cool when you come off. And here's the one thing I never used to praise myself for anything. I've won England Strongest Man for a second time, and I was like, don't feel anything off that. Felt miserable. Felt horrendous. I'm like, that's fucking stupid. I was always looking to the next thing. But I'll take what I did, and I'll find the good things, and I'll debrief myself, and I go, this went well. We need to repeat this. This did not go well. We need to improve this. And then it's like, what's next, which is the next workshop. But yeah, people generally, you know what's funny? Have you seen like Gary Neville's overlap? Is that what it's called?
No.
Do you follow football? No, you hate football.
No,
right, cool.
No, rugby guy.
Yeah. So I love all sport. I'm fucking obsessed. But Gary Neville is like, he's got a YouTube channel. I think it's his. And he's interviewing Roy Keane, and Roy Keane's the same. I think if you think, do you know Roy Keane?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you think of that personality and you think big, scary man. And I get that a lot.
Okay. Interesting.
I get that a lot with social media. Like, you know, you talk about social media. I don't have a big following. Right. Here's a funny thing. So someone was, I won't drop their name. I don't know if they want to be known as this person. So they were like, they're a friend. It's cool. I don't want to drop them in it. But they were like, when I first saw your Instagram account, I thought you were arrogant because you only followed 4 people. Number one, I just don't care what people think. Mm-hmm. I rarely do now. I'm like, I don't give a shit. Cool. Number two, I do follow people. I have another account. Mm. Not to keep it separate because I want that to be 4 people. Fuck that. The first account I had was set up by the late, great Aaron Page, one of my coaches. I didn't know how to use it. I just didn't know what it was back then. This is a long time ago. And I started following people on there. So I follow people that are educational and people that are inspirational. So I have stuff I look through. And I was just like, I don't need to follow them twice, do I? And she's like, well, because of the opinion that I gave, other people will think that. I'm like, so I have this thing where I think people think of me as a certain thing, but when they meet me, I'm slightly different. This is why I like doing the podcast.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if it's because I've worked for Eddie Baruta and Nick Mitchell that I don't tend to find many people scary doing educational seminars. Like, I don't got that same thing. Like, when you sit in front of Eddie, the most angry Bulgarian or Romanian, I don't speak to him enough for him to get angry at that. But, you know, you tend to don't find anyone else scary anymore. But yeah, like I totally get that with like, I suppose like the recall thing is probably that repetition. You write a program every day. You're going to be able to recall a lot of program design stuff. Like I've worked mentoring trainers and educating weekly for probably the last 5 years. And in those 5 years, I used to be like reading the script and be like, right, I need to be good at this. I need to prove I'm of standard to stand the front. Whereas now, so someone says, hey, you're going to talk about this in 5 minutes. I'm like, okay, cool. I'll do all right. But I think one of the best things, and you know, that I've taken from education that really opened my eyes to the pros, the strengths and weaknesses I have in terms of communication, was moving countries and educating people in a different continent. Like in London, people, the fitness industry in the UK is UK, Australia, some parts of America is like the best for the fitness industry by far. Like people came in, they were eager, they knew a little bit about stuff, they'll ask questions, and like, I got a lot more of that. If it was good, I got told. If it was bad, I got told. Whereas here, like, it's people in Hong Kong, and at the risk of coming across as a slightly racist on a podcast, this might end me. But it's not culture to ask questions. Was it good? Yes. Do you understand? Yes. Are you sure? Yes. You know, like, they're always shaking their head. Like, no, like this. You get a yes regardless of the question, and you just have to pick up a vibe. I love not why picking up vibes in education meetings and moving out here.
But that it is a cultural thing. It's different. It's like if you look at the way the Russian, right? I should read you a passage from this Russian text, and they're giving feedback on how. So they had this meet. I can't remember what it's called. They had this meet once a year. These different Russian teams.
Okay.
And they're giving feedback on the team, so they do it every year. So like last year they did this and this year they did this, and they are brutal Okay. I'm a very direct person. I can appreciate that, but they are fucking tearing this team apart. Should have done this. You're obviously not doing this. I can't remember how I got onto this now. I need to eat, but I'm definitely a very direct person with that. And I think the cultural thing is important. It's why Russian and Bulgarian systems don't work in the UK. The first time I read this was Glenn Penley and his stuff. Obviously, he's not with us anymore, but the weightlifting coach. And he was like, I want to have Olympic medalists. I want to provide that. And he came up with MDUSA, and it's something I'm trying to do here with Strongman. And it was his passion that he was chasing until the very end. And he was like, I can't train. He got Abijayev to come over and coach. And it was like, he can't do it. Because as soon as Abijayev goes, no, there's the Americans go and cry. Yeah. I know it's an extreme example. It's not what happened, but, and I'm not saying the Americans are soft or anything, but it's just the way the culture is in that country. The Soviets can just be really direct, really brutal. If you don't like it, fuck off. Another thing Charles used to say, and this is the difference between Charles's coaching theory and, say, Charlie Francis, okay? Charles has an ice cream shop. I have chocolate and vanilla. If you want strawberry, fuck off. Okay, I do two things. It's very direct, bosh, 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 bosh. And that's the way he trained people. And I tried that approach. It doesn't work for me. I'm better with the Charlie Francis approach, where he's holistic and he's adapting to the individual. I'm not the best at it. I get that. I'm still trying to learn. But early on my career, direct, Soviet, Bulgarian, Charles Poliquin approach only got me so far with certain people. You'd lose a lot more than you'd gain. But if you want to be financially stable and then you also want to bring the best out of each person, different.
Yeah. You hit the nail on the head with Charles. I remember doing bioprint in Marbella with him. And towards the end of his career or life, should we say, he there was two kinds of Charles, and you'll know this obviously very, very, very well. You get the really good on top of his game seminar Charles, where it's just like you learn so much about your craft, it's amazing. And you get the Charles where it's 2 days of telling stories. They're both fantastic, but very different ways. And I remember this was like, he spent half the seminar sleeping on the floor in the gym. And we had Carlos with him, who was like doing his measurements. And we like, he started off with like, he'd go, he'd take a calipers and he'd be like, someone will measure it. And he'll just go, he'll point and someone go, 14. And then towards the end of the weekend, he stopped caring. He was clearly a bit more tired. He grabs someone's hamstring and just go, fat. And that was it. And I was just like, oh, fuck. It was non-PC and wouldn't get away with it today. But as you said, it's everything, everything the industry is. Like, there wouldn't be a UP. There wouldn't be a lot of the programs that's, you know, we both use. There wouldn't be a lot of what this industry is without Charles Poliquin. To tie us off, because I know you need to go and eat. So if you had to do only one lift for the rest of your life, what would it be? Log. Why the log? You love the log. Why have all the lifts? Why the log?
I mean, it's just something fun about launching a heavy weight over your head. From floor to overhead, obviously. Mm. Log clean and push press would be, if you went specific lift, it would be that. There's so many elements you can train with that. I can train all strength qualities, but it's full body. It's fun. I see it as a very, right. I love the log because you can be Hmong strong, as we call it, or, you know, whatever kind of strength, just strong, pure brute strength. But the guy with the technically best, the efficient technique, they're the ones that are going to win. So I like the fact that it's a technical lift. I like the fact that you have to look at so many different things. And that's what appeals to me with regards to Olympic weightlifting. It's vastly different because they're all about speed strength, whereas the top end of mine, I can actually use maximal strength and even strength speed because the lockout is a push press where they have to get under things. Anyway, it's the log. It's because you have to test so many factors of strength.
I love the answer. And if with all the things you've done, you know, you've owned a gym, you've owned an online product, you've become a competitive strongman, you've done education. Like, in terms of your career, if there was a legacy, there's something you want to be known for, what would you like people to look back on your career and say, Tom Hibbert was the guy for?
Fuck, I don't know. I don't know where we're going to end up with it. I'm still going. I'm still at my infancy. I still think I know things. That's really difficult. I don't want to pigeonhole myself into just, I think strength and performance.
Okay.
He's the best at strength and performance, not the best. Obviously, it's opinion based and there's so many different people, obviously Louis and Charles, strength and performance. But I can't pinpoint one strength quality. I can't pinpoint one event. I can't pinpoint one sport. I think if you had to, if you put a bullet to my head, a gun to my head, it would be strongman. It would be strength athletes. I have a lot of passion for that. But I have a lot of passion for athletic performance because strength athletes, like some of these guys will only compete, you know, between one or four times a year. That's a long time to like wait and get excited about watching people compete. Whereas with the athletic performance, they only peak once a year, but you get all this buildup and you get all these intermittent things. Like I do get excited by competition. Now, if it was a football team and making them champions by the end of the year, but seeing the constant battles they have during the year. Sorry, really difficult question. Strength and performance, anything strength and performance.
Cool. I think that's a good answer. So this has been an awesome, awesome chat. So for anyone who wants to know, learn more about you, where can people find Tom Hibbert?
We've amalgamated everything into winningstrength.com. Everything's on there. All of my products, the articles, the free videos. We have membership options if you want to learn more online training. But I love to put content out. I think it's cool to try and share some thoughts and get feedback from people, but winningstrength.com is where you'll find me. And thank you so much for having me. This has genuinely been different and fun with regards to podcasts that I've been on.
Oh well, thank you very much. I massively appreciate that. As you said, very direct. It's the strength coaches that worked under Charles that it's been the best compliments. One is got excited. He's very direct. Coming and goes, it's been different and fun. And the second one was when I did Stefan's recording with Stefan. I got a message from his partner just saying, just to make sure you're aware of Stefan's background, because we've had a couple of people do podcasts with him and they've not really done their research. I'm sitting there going, I've followed the guy for 10 years. I've bought half his program. How much is he expecting me to know? Is he expecting me to know his favorite food? And I came on to the call. He's not a talker naturally until you get him onto something. He was like, hey, yeah, so how are you? Good. Is there anything you particularly want to talk about and like any particular topics? Nope. Okay. And he got to the end and was like, I really enjoyed that. I'm like, oh, for that. I was like, yeah. I'd say I could retire. And yeah, so, but yeah, that's thank cool. you so much for having me on. And I suppose follow you on Instagram. Where's your Instagram? And if you follow back, they know someone's made it. If you get a follow.
Yeah. I'll follow you on Winning Strength Online. But the Instagram tag is tom.hibbert1, I believe.
And I would definitely urge people to go follow that. You know, just the videos you've been put up, certainly the ones that are recently put up, are really, really, really good.
I've hired a marketing manager recently to really help me with this because it's not a strength. And I have a videographer as well who works with me 3 days a week. So there's a lot of different content. But you're right. We've worked very hard at trying to produce some quality content for people to try and take something from.
One of your videos recently was like, there's two things in terms of like mobility that has blown my mind. One was from a guy called Douglas Heal, and one was from one of your videos. The Douglas Heal one I went to the Be Activated. Have you ever done Douglas Heal? Do you know of Douglas Heal?
I've just remembered I have, and I think I know. Is it fucking painful?
Yeah, it's really painful.
Yeah, I know.
Rubbing your diaphragm, like that sort of stuff.
Oh, Jesus, the jaw, the massive.
Oh, unreal. But I remember this guy came in, and if I hadn't started speaking to him earlier on, I generally would have thought it was a plant. And he came in with these glasses on. And he knew he got people up at the start of the course. Every now and again, like intermittent the course, each point, he'll get somebody up. And it was always really good that you got the right people up. You just knew. And he got this guy coming in. He said he was blind in one eye. And he started working around his serratus anterior. And as he noticed he was getting to his blind spot, he flinched and it was really painful. So he just slowly worked and it slowly worked and slowly worked on it. When he got off the table, he said he could see blurs in one eye. He kept working, Next day, the guy came in with his glasses on.
Get out of here.
And I'm just like, what? I doubled up my anatomy knowledge. For the last like 6-7 years after that course, I've studied more anatomy than ever before. And I still don't know what on earth happened. And the second thing was your video where you got the guy to take out his piercing and all of a sudden his range just changed.
That happens but more often real. Than you can imagine. It wasn't. I had people like, oh, it's a trick. It's this, it's that. And then I obviously... I'm very interested in the science behind it, but I don't care if I know it or not. And yeah. So you know this serratus anterior thing?
Yeah.
With regards to the eye? Is that what it was?
Yeah. If you're going to give me an answer, this
it'll be a no. I won't give you the answer, but it'll be... Peter was talking about an activation through the trigeminal nerve. I think it's cranial nerve 5 or 6.
Hmm.
And it's a nervous system issue. This is the same thing that I did with the nose piercing or the multiple piercing, whatever it is. Peter's like, my opinion is it's done something different to the nervous system. There's a different input and output based on that. And I've seen it so many times, but the science is interesting. And this is why, so this is Peter's theory on why Charles's PIMST, polyquin instant muscle strengthening technique things work. Like you see the really famous one of the masseter, the guy's hamstrings going crazy. But it's to do with cranial nerve 5 and 6, trigeminal nerve and facial nerve. And there'll be a link there with regards to the guy's eye. It'll be a nerve input. If you ask Peter, you'll get a good answer.
I always thought with that, I thought there was something down to that. And I also thought with the master thing as well, is that like they always test it with a toe touch. And like with the toe touch not necessarily being a solely a test for hamstring strength. Like how much is the ability to flex the cervical spine going to affect how you flex the thoracic? And that's what's getting you the extra range rather than your hamstrings are changing. But I'm sure it's probably a combination of the two.
Oh, for sure. There'll be a combination of shit. But Peter, you want to know about injuries and these parlor tricks or whatever Peter want to call them. It's all to do with the nervous system. So whatever happened with this guy's eye, it could have been a pain thing and certain endorphins, but then it's a different activation on the nervous system. That's a pretty cool result that guy's got there.
I haven't spoken to Douglas in a long time. Maybe I'll try and get with the podcast and ask him that directly and see if we can get an answer. Thank you so much today. It's been a lot of fun. I'll put in the show notes where to find you, and thank you very much.
Cheers, buddy. Thanks very much.